So just to say, if you're watching online, I'm sure you know this, but if we go to the Archer webpage, Archer AC UK, go to training and upcoming courses, we can click on the scientific computing course, which is this course, and then there's a link to the course materials here. Links to be here. So all the material I'll be giving is available here. There's also the hack pad, which you can you can type things in if you have any issues. I'm just waiting 5 minutes to let things settle down a bit. So just to recap, for if you weren't here last week, these courses are part of the Archer program, which Archer is the national supercomputer, which is run by EPCC. I'm in charge of training at EPCC, which involves the MSc and various other training. And that was just to introduce myself. The lecture I'm going to give today, as I mentioned, explained last week, scientific computing, it requires large amounts of computer power, and so it's synonymous with parallel computing these days. So today I'm going to really talk about parallel computing, not from the hardware side of things, but how you actually, the conceptual side and how you actually write parallel programs. Then next week I'll go into, I won't be talking about parallel computing. Next week I'll talk about more numerics, the numeric side of scientific computing, where we work with floating point real numbers and the issues that causes. And in the final week I'll move on to various standard techniques, standard techniques for very large scale computations. But today I'll be talking about parallel programming concepts and such like. So an outline, I'm going to talk just about a very high level about what the common decomposition techniques are for parallel programs. And it's worth in the back of your mind while I'm doing these, thinking about the traffic model, which I introduced last week. Think of that as a serial program and then think about how you might parallelize it. And see, you can sort of have in the back of your mind how these techniques might be relevant or not relevant. And I'll talk a bit about parallel performance models and metrics and how to quantify how your program is running. So, well, why use parallel programming? It's harder than serial programming, so why bother? Well, I motivated that last week. Although parallel programming is more difficult than sequential programming, we're no longer riding this the Moore's law benefits of single processor performance. So single processors are no longer getting any faster. The only way that chips, processors, computers get more powerful is because they have multiple processors in them. And there are some fundamental limits, such as speed of light. In fact, the size of atoms is getting to become a limit. I'm not a hardware engineer, but the individual tracks on modern processors are tens of atoms wide, and therefore, you know, things get very difficult to control at that level. But parallelism isn't the silver bullet, and this lecture is really just going to go over the concepts of what you need to think about before you parallelize a code. So the performance is to get, the aim is performance. You want to solve the same problem faster, and that can be for two reasons, to improve the time to solution. So if you're an engineer designing a new aircraft wing and you want to make it as efficient as possible. If it takes a week to do that, you design a new aircraft wing and it takes a week to find out what the lift and the drag on that aircraft wing is, that's not very useful. But if that can be reduced to 10 hours, you can submit a job when you go home at night and come back in the morning and see if your design is better. If you can get that down to minutes, then it can change the whole design process. You can interactively alter things and get feedback. So it can improve the time to solution or enable new scientific problems to be solved. So we're at the stage now where you can run global climate simulations. That would have been unthinkable 20 years ago. You know, you were struggling to run the weather simulations across a small set of islands like the UK. But now we can do, you know, relatively high resolution global simulations. So ideally we'd like to run P times faster on P processor or processor cores. Okay, so if I've got one processor and one processor core, it takes 4 minutes. If I have four processor cores, surely it'll take 1 minute. Well, unfortunately, that's not true. Not all parts of a program can be successfully split up. We saw last week, I had this very simple example of summing up a big list of numbers. We saw there that even in that simple part, you could parallelize, you could easily split up the summation, but there was an extra stage where you had to communicate at the end. And that splitting the program up itself may incur additional overheads. And those overheads are typically, they're not always communication. So how we split a problem up in parallel is critical. And what we want to do, we'll see that splitting up a problem incurs communication. The processes have to speak to each other. We want to limit that. But also we want to balance the load. I mentioned last week that in that simple adding up a list of numbers, we had 7 billion numbers. It's fairly trivial to give 3.5 billion numbers to each process. But in real situations, that can be difficult to achieve. So what we call tightly coupled problems are problems where the processes, the individual tasks, have to talk to each other a lot. And it turns out that most scientific and technical problems are of this tightly coupled nature. And in fact, we'll see that the traffic model is of that nature. What people tend to call embarrassingly parallel problems require very little or no interaction between the parallel tasks. And the image sharpening exercise, which I described last week, is of that nature. You read in a data set, you distribute it, and once it's distributed, we have each process or each task operating on a different subset of the image. Those tasks are completely independent. And then at the end, you maybe get together, but during the calculation, they're completely independent. People tend to call that embarrassingly parallel. It's fairly obvious there that it's going to go four times faster, approaching four times faster and four times as many cores. So the image sharpening exercise is embarrassingly parallel in that sense. Why? I don't know why it's called embarrassing, but that's the standard terminology. But the most scientific and technical and real problems are of the tightly coupled nature, and that is, for example, the traffic model. Or we sit somewhere between the two. So how do we split problems up to solve efficiently in parallel? Well, this is the most challenging. You know, you have a calculation to do. You have to manually or semi-manually assign different parts of the calculation to different processor cores. How do you do it? And that depends on the nature of the problem, the amount of communication required, and what support you have. You know, what kind of, we'll see that there are two, we'll cover today, there are two really fundamental programming models. One is shared memory based on threads programming. One is distributed memory based on multiple processes. And, you know, how you parallelize your problem will be different potentially depending on which of those parallel models you're targeting. But I'm very quickly going to go some very simple, commonly used decompositions, ways of splitting your problem up. And the most obvious one, and this is typically done, I think I mentioned this last week a bit, is a geometric decomposition. You want to simulate, you know, the weather over some area, including here land and sea, and you split it up. And you give different areas of the problem to different processes. So if you're splitting up an aeroplane, one process could be doing one wing, another process doing another wing, one process doing the fuselage, one doing the tail, or something like that, naively. And that will incur, require some communication between those processes, because clearly, you know, the weather in each box depends on the weather in another box, but it all turns out that, well, if you're lucky, or if you've constructed your model in a particular way, those dependencies could be relatively localized. So typically, we'll see in most scientific problems where you're solving partial differential equations to simulate things like the weather, the interactions are local. So you're stepping through time. You might be updating this model every 5 minutes. That might be your time step. Clearly, unless you have a very, very fast wind, you know, the weather cannot, the influence of the weather can't travel more than a fixed distance in a fixed period of time. And that gives you kind of a local domain of interaction, which means that each processor probably needs to only communicate with its, in this case, 8 nearest neighbors, and also it only needs to communicate limited data with its 8 neighbors. And what you tend to see is, well, you might then worry, well, actually, wait a second, some of these processes have got just, I haven't put Ireland on here, but if I look maybe top right, some of these processes just have sea, okay? Now, clearly, you have to do some work to simulate the weather over the sea, but presumably it's easier than simulating the weather over the land. There's a lot less going on. The sea is a uniform flat surface. The land has hills and different all kinds of different things going on. So isn't there a problem here? Isn't the processor that gets the sea possibly going to finish quicker than the processor gets the land? And that's true. So what you can try and do is, we'll talk about how to do that later on. But splitting the problem up does have an associated cost, and there is communications. And typically we talk about the granularity of the decomposition. So on the left, if I had that decomposition there, I split the Great Britain up into the UK up into four pieces. There's not enough parallelism there. If I can't run on more than six processor cores. On the right hand side, I might say it's great, I'll split it up in lots and lots of little chunks, I'll give each chunk to a different processor, then I can use lots and lots of processors. But if your if your granularity is too small, if your tasks are too small, then the communications rule, and you end up spending all your time communicating. So for example, in the adding up the list of 7 billion numbers, if I decided to use 3.5 billion people to do that calculation, everybody would have got two numbers. Okay, they would have spent all their time communicating at the end. Each person would have had only a tiny calculation to do, adding two numbers together, and then all 3.5 billion of us would have had to get together to compute the total. And so there is always a balance between utilizing your processor resources on the and induced overheads. And the example which I'll give out, which illustrates that in a slightly different context from this, but does illustrate it, is computing the Mandelbrot set. You get some nice pictures of the Mandelbrot set, colourful pictures, but that's there to illustrate this trade-off between parallelism and overheads. And the reason this works is that it turns out the communications between these processors is around the boundaries. And so, for example, if I'm the processor in the middle, I need to know what's going on the boundaries of the processors near me. So I need to know what's going on the bottom slice of the guy above me, the top slice of the guy below me, the right slice of the guy to my left, and the left slice of the guy to my right, and possibly the diagonals. And that's because in a single time step, if we have a wind blowing, information may have traveled that distance. Okay, so it's a fixed distance, but it means we do need to continually update every time step, every iteration. We need to update information, and this is exactly analogous to the traffic model. So one of the exercises for this week is to think about parallelizing the traffic model. And it's a simple 1D model, it has the same characteristics as this. You might say, well, wait a second, the weather isn't a 2D process, the weather has height as well. We have, I don't know how many miles, 5, 10 miles of atmosphere. Well, typically, there's a lot of interaction in that direction. There's a lot going on. Also, the scales are much smaller. You can see that square there is probably, what's that? These squares are hundreds of miles across. But the column of air you might simulate might only need to be a mile high. I don't know how high up you have to go. So what you do is you don't split the weather in the vertical direction. Each process is responsible for a whole column of weather. That's because there's lots of interactions going on in that direction vertically. And if you split that between processes, it would induce an enormous amount of communications. So to reduce the communications, you say, well, each processor or core will have a complete column of the atmosphere, but we'll distribute it only in those two dimensions. So these are the kind of choices you have to make. So you can see if we had a decomposition like on the right, okay, we'd have a lot more communication. Fractionally, the amount of data we have to communicate will be much greater. We have a lot more messages to transfer. And so as you increase the number of processors, the local problem size typically gets smaller, and you get a much higher overhead. And eventually you reach a situation where there is some limit to how high you can go, and we'll have models to very simply later on to see where that crossover point is. At what point does it not become profitable to use more processors? The other problem that I talked about, load imbalance, there, imagine I had an image processing example. It was doing feature extraction. So I'm looking at an image and I'm trying to identify features. If I look at the top left-hand corner, there are no features. Your algorithm would run and say there's nothing there. But in the middle, where we have the eyes and the nose, then maybe you have to do a lot of work. So if I had 16 processors, 16 individual cores, and I used the decomposition on the left, if I had as many tasks, the same number of parallel tasks, as I have physical processors, then I'm going to get a problem, because the processor responsible for the top left finishes quickly and has nothing else to do. So the trick is to have multiple tasks or multiple partitions per processor. So we split the problem up into, in this case, 64 tasks, and that means that there's various ways of splitting it up, but by having more tasks than processors, you can share the load out. You can do, you might, you know, the guy who gets the top four tasks might finish early and do other stuff. The guy who gets the eyes might spend all their time doing that one task, but all the everyone else gets multiple tasks to do. So the important point there is you aren't restricted to having the same number of partitions as processors, although there is a potentially a communication cost. If you have poor load imbalance, if the balancing the load is the issue, you want to have more partitions than processors. And that's exactly the situation which is illustrated by the Mandelbrot set example. We have certain areas in the Mandelbrot set are thousands of times easier to compute than other areas. And so you'll see the example is, it's a prepackaged example, to look at the runtime as you use more and more tasks, smaller and smaller regions, for a fixed number of processors, and see how the time varies. But I think the principle is quite clear. So that's called load balance. We need to balance the load between the processors. So the trick in parallel programming is to maximize load balance or minimize load imbalance, but try and minimize the communications as well. So a simple way of doing this, and this is what we'll do in the Mandelbrot set, but you can think about it equally for that feature recognition, is you nominate, this is a very obvious example of parallel processing that goes back one of the first models that was used. You split the problem up into distinct independent tasks, and you have a controller processor, a master processor, who sends the tasks out to the workers. And when the workers are finished, they get back and they get more. So what you would do in this example, if I had 16, on the right-hand side, I give out 16 tasks, which is the first two rows of tasks, and then I just wait. And the first person that comes back, I give them more tasks. So you're dynamically balancing the load. You're using the run. You're not predetermining who's going to do the most work. You just give the work out, and when somebody's finished, you give them more work. And that's typically called a task farm, or a master worker, controller worker situation. The master process sends tasks to a worker. The worker process sends results back to the master. That's not any use if you have the same, if you have the same number of workers as you have tasks, which was the case for the image sharpening example, then you can't do any load balancing. But you have more tasks than there are workers, which is going to be the case for the Mandelbrot set. We can keep as many people busy as possible. And eventually, at the end, there's going to be some idle time when the last slowest people finish their task. But a master worker situation is a very simple way of using up parallel resources. So the task farm, if you think you want to use a task farm, the communication is between the master and the workers. Having communication between the workers complicates things. The master can become a bottleneck. If the tasks are too small, the workers get back too quickly and the master can't keep up. So you can do various things. You can send out multiple tasks, or you could implement direct worker-to-worker account. You could do work stealing and such like that. There's different models here, but that is the main problem with this model, that the master is potentially a bottleneck. You might ask about resilience, what happens if a worker stops responding? Well, in this model, because the master has all the knowledge, there is a master processor. If somebody stops responding, in principle, the master can notice that and send the work out to somebody else. So you can implement some form of fault tolerance in these models. However, may be a surprise to you, but in general, in high-performance computing, we do not implement fault tolerance. And the problem is that if we have an example like this, where each process is responsible for a certain domain of data, if a process fails, it loses that data, and then it's gone, okay? Then it's gone. If I'm responsible for the weather over Edinburgh, and I have some crash, some hardware crash, or some software fault, and I die, you can imagine having a situation where that process comes alive again and then reestablishes communication with its neighbors, but you've lost your memory, you've lost your data. And so, in fact, it turns out it's actually very difficult in these kind of domain geometric decomposition scenarios to have fault tolerance, because you have by definition distributed the data. The data is distributed across multiple processes. You're typically using a lot of memory on each process. You cannot store all the data on a single process. And so it's very hard to build in resiliency. And so that is becoming a limit. That's one of the worries, is that because we assume the hardware is reliable, that if the mean time between failure of a parallel computer gets down to less than a few hours, then it's not going to be possible to run any real calculations. However, modern computers, I mean, mean time between failures are probably days, and they tend to be local failures. They tend to be, because we have this distributed memory architecture, one node can go down and the other nodes stay up. In very early machines, one node going down brought the whole machine down, so that was bad. But nowadays, they're relatively resilient. So if a node goes down, a job running on that node will fail. And on Archer, we refund the time and let them run again. Claire won't give you your time back if you can prove that it wasn't your fault. But the whole machine doesn't go down. But it is a surprise to people. This is not a what you might classic distributed computing model, where you have where you're dealing with a very, very distributed network of computers which can come and go and be turned on and off. The model here is a single dedicated resource which is always available. So modern supercomputers will detect faults and will abort if there is a fault. So you will never get it's unlikely you get an incorrect result, but the standard behavior on a fault is actually to crash and burn. Of course, you could manually checkpoint. You know, every day you could save the state of the weather to disk, so you could manually restart. But that's done by you. The operating system, the system software doesn't give you any resilience. People are looking into going beyond that model, but it is actually very surprisingly difficult. What a classic model in the early days of parallel computing was a pipeline where you have multiple stages and you just flow data through. So each stage runs on a particular processor and each processor communicates with the processor holding the next stage. The problem here is that this has limited parallelism. You know, a particular operation might have 5 stages, 10 stages. You can't scale beyond that. And so now as the number of cores goes into the thousands, tens of thousands, hundreds of thousands, pipelines are typically not used in scientific and technical computing. We tend to parallelize each stage rather than even have multiple stages flowing it forward. I mean, there are examples of pipelines still around. CPUs have in hardware, have multi-stage pipelines. So apparently the Intel Pentium 4, which is a very old chip, had a 20-stage pipeline. And if you want to do a floating point, if you want to multiply two floating point operations together, that cannot be done in a single clock cycle. You have a long pipeline. So once you've filled the pipeline up, you're getting one answer per clock cycle because you've filled the pipe and you stick a new result in here and another one drops out at the end. But an individual calculation can take many clock cycles to complete. You can write a Unix cell or a shell. You could cat a file, grep for something and do some processing on it, which is sort of... which could be run in parallel, or there are graphics and GPU pipelines. So typically where pipelines are used in scientific computing is at a much higher level, you might have a parallel, you know, stage one might be assimilate data from your satellite, stage two might be process it, stage three might be run a weather forecast, stage four might be analyze that weather forecast to predict what the effects are going to be, stage five might be do a visualization. So at a very high level, people still use these pipelines, but typically we don't, they're not used to parallelize an individual calculation. The place where parallelism really comes in scientific and technical codes is loop parallelism. So serial programs are often dominated by computationally intensive loops. And it might be worth now, actually, if I have put up some solutions, but I have them on the screen. If you just look at, I've put up solutions on the website to the traffic modeling example. So I've lost the link. So yeah, if we go to the website, I now have solutions up. I have serial solutions for the traffic modeling exercise, and I'll come back to some example results from the Sharpen exercise. But I've downloaded these serial solutions to a machine, which I have access to here. I'll do a full screen on this. Hopefully that font is readable. So I'll just do the C example. So there's C, Fortran and Python, I've called P. I'll do the C one, for example. And let's just look at that. Oh, okay. Traffic.c. I have to take the font mode lock off because it. I mean, I don't have time to go through it, but I've got a very large large number of cells. So here I've got, I think it's 100,000 cells I'm running on. I allocate all the data and stuff. But the main thing I do is I have this loop, and I talked about it last week, that we do many iterations for iter equals one, iter less than max, iter double plus. We update the boundary conditions, and if you read the sheet, you'll see that we actually are simulating the car not on a road, but on a roundabout. And I decided to implement periodic boundary conditions in a particular way. So that, it's actually the end move equals update road. This is the major computational loop. I have a function called update road, which computes the new road based on the old road for a particular number of cells, and then I copy back for the next iteration. But it's that update road, and this is going to. Okay, that's okay. There we are. Oh no, that's not the right loop. Sorry. The update road loop is just about going to fit on the screen. You'll see I have a road of length n, I loop over the whole road, and the update rules are, if the old road is 1, so there was a cell there, if the old road up the way was 1, then it can't move to the new road. So that first case is a car with a car ahead of it, it can't move. The second case is a car without a car ahead of it, and then it can move, and then I call that a number of moves. So this first case, if the old road is full, it can't move if the next cell is full, but it can move if the next cell isn't full. And this is the case where this is the empty case, if there was somebody down the way, then I now become full, else I stay zero. And I don't increment the number of moves there because that would be a double count. But this is, you know, this is classic of, there's two very important points about this loop. First of all, for every iteration, you loop over the whole domain, I equals 1, I less than equal to n, I double plus. The equivalent in weather modeling would be each time you go forward 5 minutes in time, you have to loop over the entire map of the UK. And secondly, cells depend on their neighbors. And for a real physical simulation, that comes from the way that you map the periodic, the partial differential equations onto a grid. But in this case, you can see that the state of a cell depends on its upward neighbor, itself, and its downward neighbor. And so to update cell I need information from cell I minus 1, and cell I plus 1. So that's why this is representative of real scientific and technical calculations. You have an update rule where the new state depends on the state of itself and its neighbors. And in two dimensions, it's probably its state and its neighbors left and right. But this, if you think about parallelizing this, it's this fact. The reason this isn't a trivially parallel or embarrassingly parallel calculation is precisely because the state of a cell depends on the state of its neighbors, and they're all changing. And you'll see, you can just conceptually, when you think about, if you try splitting this calculation up between processors, between processor cores, it's that dependence of I on I minus 1 and I plus 1 which induces communications. And I'll give out parallel solutions next week, which you can play around with if you want to. So that was something of an aside, but I thought it was useful to show you. But loop parallelism is really serial programs often dominated by computation intensive loops. You know, you look at a code, do I equals 1 to a million, do j equals 1 to a million. These are huge loops. If you go for loop-based parallelism, which we'll see in the next lecture, really requires a shared memory model, a shared memory architecture, you can incrementally parallelize different loops. So it tends to work with small-scale parallelism. It's not suited to all architectures. And so if the runtime's not dominated by loops, or some loops can't be parallelized, then these can dominate. And this leads on something called Amdahl's law, which is a very simple model of parallel performance, which I will illustrate at the end of today. But loop parallelism, I mean, here's an example of real code, and we'll cover these concepts a bit later. We have a very large array, A, the array is of size, again, oh, that's 10,000, no, it's 100,000. And I have a loop for I equals 0, I less than ni double plus, ai equals 2 times I, okay? So clearly that loop can be parallelized. You know, you're just simply, this is a trivially parallel loop because there's the state of I just depends on I. There's no communication here. And there are, we'll see there are methods An OpenMP is the programming model, which I'll talk about later, which allows you to automatically parallelize this loop. Well, sorry, which allows the user to say that that he or she wants this loop to be parallelized. And you stick in these kind of pragmas, hash pragma OMP parallel 4 says, please execute this loop in parallel. And I'll talk a bit about how that works in the future, in the next lectures. But this is loop, because loops are such a, effectively dominate the runtime of most scientific and technical codes, scientific computing, this can be quite a useful model. And the nice thing about this, I don't know if you know the way that hash pragmas work in C, but a hash pragma is a hint to the compiler, which a compiler will ignore if it doesn't understand it. So this program can be run in serial and in parallel. If you compile this with GCC with no parallelism, it would ignore that loop and run it in serial. If you compiled it in GCC and turned on OpenMP parallel with minus F OpenMP, it would parallelize it. And we'll talk about these concepts a bit later on. So, you know, we can see there are various ways of parallelizing codes. We've talked about task farms, we've talked about domain decomposition, geometric decomposition, which really is the most common method which is used. We've talked about loop-based parallelism. But how can I quantify how my code is performing? You know, I've gone away, I've taken a program, I now parallelize it, I run it, have I done a good job? So the typical performance metrics are, so the model we're going to have is that we have two categories of code. We have inherently sequential sections that can't be run in parallel, and we have potentially parallel sections. And if you did the Sharpen exercise from last week, the way to think about these is inherently sequential section is reading the data in from file, for example. As I said, I had a very simple model. I nominated a master processor who read the image, the fuzzy image, in from file. And then we have potentially parallel section, which is the calculation, which in the Sharpen exercise turns out to be embarrassingly parallel, and that's run in parallel. So, but the metrics we use, the classic one is speed up. Okay, if I run on 10 processors, does my program go 10 times faster? So I measure the time taken. So my TNP is the time taken for a problem size n on p processors. Now, for this slide, the problem size n isn't relevant, but we'll come back to it later. But what it's saying is the speed up is the time taken on one processor divided by the time taken on p processors. So if it took 10 seconds on one processor and 1 second on 10 processors, my speed up would be 10, okay? Which is typically the speed up is less than the number of processors. Typically, there were overheads and you will not achieve that. But the typical metric you will hear people talk about is speed up. I got a speed up of 1,000 on 1,024 processors is the things that people talk about. The other way to quantify that is efficiency. We divide the speed up by the number of processors. So that's just speed up divided by P. So if you say my parallel program is 100% efficient, that means it runs P times faster on P processors. You rarely get that. You get some tail off. So your program might be 90% efficient, 50% efficient. The thing you have to worry about, though, and people do tend to ignore, is the serial efficiency. This is saying that actually, in order to parallelize your code, you're not interested in how much faster your parallel program went compared to your parallel program on one process. You're interested in how much faster your parallel program on P processes went than your serial program. And in order to parallelize a program, you sometimes have to do a different approach, a new algorithm, and that may have some inherent overheads. So you really ought to talk about the serial efficiency. Well, you know, T best of N is the best algorithm I could do for that problem. The ratio of that to the time it took with my parallel algorithm. You know, did I take a hit simply to do it in parallel? Did I take a factor of 10 hit because I had to use a different algorithm in parallel from in serial? Now, typically people don't quote this. People typically, say things like, oh, it's great, you know, my program goes 1,000 times faster on 1,000 processors. And you have to be aware that, well, maybe if you'd run on one process, there was actually a more efficient way to do it. So maybe that's really only a speed up of 100. So you do have to be careful about this, that you may have taken a hit, you may have had to choose a simpler or different algorithm simply to be able to parallelize the problem. I'm trying to think if I can think of an example for that. I can't think of one off the top of my head. So this The model we have is that we have inherently sequential sections like the I/O in the sharpening exercise and potentially parallel sections. And so a long time ago, almost 50 years ago, a guy called Gene Amdahl made the fairly obvious statement that the performance improvement to be gained by parallelization is limited by the proportion of the code which is serial. So for example, if I have a program which is 50% serial and 50% parallel, I can speed up the parallel part. It runs in 1 second on one process, half a second, a quarter second, an eighth of a second, but the serial part still takes the same amount of time. And so overall, I don't get very good speed up. Although I've improved the performance of my serial part in this linear way, the overall speed up on eight processes here is only 1.8. And it's fairly obvious to see that there is no way you can get more than the speed up of two, because I have 1 second serial and 1 second parallel, potentially parallel. I can take that potentially parallel part infinitely small by running on an infinite number of processors, but I can never reduce the runtime to less than 1 second. And so Gene Amdahl actually used that as a way of saying parallel programming wasn't going to be any use, because if you want to use 1,000 processors, you have to have something like, you have to have about 0.1% of your program has to be serial. 99.9% of your program has to be parallelizable to utilize 1,000 cores. And modern machines have tens, hundreds of thousands of cores. How are we ever going to find a problem which is 99.99999% parallel? And this seems like an issue. And there's a natural example. It's like saying, you know, is it worth, if I fly to New York, okay, from my house to New York, there's one part that might take me, say, I don't know, 14 hours door to door, okay? 10 hours door to door, say. And the reason it takes that is there might be 7 hours flying, okay? But 3 hours is like my serial over. 3 hours is driving to the airport, checking in, going through customs at the other end, going through immigration and getting the tube or the subway in New York. So if it takes me 10 hours to go from Edinburgh to New York, 7 hours is flying, you might say, well, that's great, I could get a faster plane, I could get Concorde. You're kind of crazy to fly Concorde, well, it doesn't exist anymore, but flying a Concorde from Edinburgh to New York is not worthwhile because you've got this 3 hours, which is a fixed overhead, okay? So you can say that for short-haul flights, there is no demand for very fast planes. For problems which have a large serial component, there's no demand for very fast parallel computing. But what you can say, well, wait a second, I'll just do a bigger journey. I'll fly from Edinburgh to Perth in Australia, okay? There it's 24 hours flying time, but still 3 hours fixed overhead, okay? The overheads are the same, assuming it's a direct flight. I have to still, you know, check in, whatever. The point is that if you make the problem bigger, you make the distance bigger, in a lot of cases, the sequential overhead stays the same. An analogy is having a fast mode of transport with some slow part at the end. So you want to have a big journey. So you can improve the portion of the journey whose performance is improved by having a fast airplane is bigger. And so this was Amdahl's law. So Amdahl's law, just it really is a fairly straightforward observation, but in equations, if you assume a fraction of alpha of your calculation is completely serial, then the time of again, I'm keeping n fixed here, n will come back in later, but the time it takes on p processors is the serial part, which is alpha times the time it takes on one processor. But we're saying that the other part, the one minus alpha part, scales linearly with the number of processors. So there's this fixed overhead, which is fixed, previously was 1 second, and this other part, whose runtime decreases linearly with the number of processors, assuming the parallel part is 100% efficient. And then if you compute the parallel speed up, it's just a bit of turn the handle, it's p of alpha p plus alpha minus 1. And that's fairly obvious. If alpha is 0, where you have 0 serial time, then clearly the speed up is p, which is, as we'd expected, 100% efficiency if I have no serial part. But otherwise, the speed up is limited by 1 upon alpha for any p. That right-hand side, if you take p to infinity, it becomes 1 upon alpha. And that's just saying, if 10% of my calculation is serial, I can never make the code go more than 10 times as fast. Because if my code takes 10 seconds, 1 second of it is serial, that cannot be improved by parallelization, so my speed up is limited by 10. So put some numbers in, if my code is 10% serial, then my maximum speed up is 10. So for example, if I run the problem on 16 processors, it goes 6.5 times faster, not 16 times faster. If I run 1,024 processors, it goes only 10 times faster. So clearly, for this problem, you'd be mad to run on 1,024 processors, because that program is only 1% efficient. Instead of going 1,000 times faster, it's going 10 times faster. It's only 1% parallel efficiency. You're gaining almost nothing by going from 16 to 1,024 processors. So this seems like the death for parallel computing, but it isn't, because all you have to say, and this is the equivalent of saying, well, if I want to use a fast mode of transport like a Concorde, I need to fly a long way to make it worthwhile, you need to use larger problems. So Gustafsson's law is just a way of quantifying that. We need larger problems for larger numbers of processors. So if we take a program which is 8 times as big, then on 8 processors, the speed up is 4.5 as opposed to 1.8. Now, this does assume that if you make the problem bigger, the serial fraction, the serial part takes the same time. So that is true of my analogy for traveling by aeroplane. No matter how far I travel by aeroplane, assuming it's a single flight, the check-in and customs at each end is kind of the same. And it turns out that this is actually largely true for scientific and technical calculations. If you make the problem sizes bigger, then the serial overhead tends, the serial time tends to stay the same. The amount of parallelism grows. And to think about that, that is not true of the Sharpen example. So the Sharpen example illustrates Amdahl's law, where you have a perfectly parallelizable part and an inherently sequential part. It does not illustrate Gustafsson's law, because if you think about it, the compute time of that problem is scaled with the number of pixels, and the I/O time scaled with the number of pixels. So that's an atypical problem. If you think about the traffic model, though, you can see that this is going to be true. So I don't want to jump ahead, but if you think about doing a domain decomposition of the traffic model, you have a large road and you give each process a subsection of that road. If you think about it, the communications is only at the edges. You only need to communicate with your nearest neighbor, and you only need to communicate the edge cells, because the state of each cell only depends on its neighbors, I minus one and I plus one. And that means if you have a long road and you split it up amongst processors, you only need to communicate the boundary data. So no matter how big your problem is, you need to communicate one element up and one element down. And that's effectively the serial component of that calculation. And that stays in that serial component, which is actually a communications overhead, but it's the same concept, stays fixed regardless of the problem size. So as you increase the problem size, your problem becomes more efficient. The other way you can see about that is if you look at the weather forecasting. The amount of data that has to be communicated is a surface term. It's the boundary of your local data set, whereas the calculation is the volume, the amount. You have to loop over all the elements in the middle to update your calculation, but you have to communicate the boundary. So if I make the problem 10 times bigger in X and Y, I have 100 times as much calculation to do, but only 10 times as much communication. The communication scales as a surface term, whereas the calculation scales as a volume term. One scales as L, one scales as L squared. So although it doesn't exactly follow Gustafsson's law, it follows the principle: as the calculation gets bigger, the amount of parallelization increases. So if you just churn the numbers, you can say that if you scale the problem size with the number of processors, then you can get decent efficiency. So for example, we saw that previously the speed up, for this case where alpha was 0.1, previously the speed up for n 16 processors was, 6.4, and n 1024 was 9.9. If we the speed up for 60 times n and 16 is 14.5, the speed up for 1024 times n and 1024 is 921. We can maintain almost constant parallel efficiency as long as we get bigger problems. So what this means is, if the Weather Forecast Bureau get a machine which is 10 times faster, they don't do the same forecast 10 times quicker. They don't say, well, it took us 10 hours to do the weather forecast today. If you give me a machine that's 10 times faster, I can do the same weather forecast in 1 hour. What they do is they solve the problem on a finer grid. They solve the problem on 10 times as many points, okay? So they can do larger, more accurate simulations. They can process more data. So you make the model bigger. You increase the model complexity or size as you get more processors. So I've taught scaling is how the performance of a parallel application changes the number of processors is increased. And there are two types of scaling, strong scaling and weak scaling. And they correspond to the two examples I just gave of weather modeling. Strong scaling is total problem size stays the same as the number of processors increases. So you've given me more processors. How much faster can I solve the same model on these processors? Weak scaling is taking advantage of Gustafsson's law, saying, well, you've given me 10 times as many processors, I'll solve a problem which is 10 times as big. I keep the amount of work per processor the same. And in fact, strong scaling is generally more useful. In a lot of cases, strong scaling is generally more useful. You want to solve the same problem more quickly, but it's more difficult to achieve. You have to, it's harder to keep the parallelization overheads manageable with strong scaling. So the typical graph that people will tell you is, look, I parallelize my code and I plot the speed up, which is the time on one process divided by the time on p processors against the number of processors. If I had perfect, it would be linear. It would go 256 times faster on 256 processors. But actually, I don't have a linear scale. I have something, and due to Amdahl's law, it tails off at some point. Weak scaling looks a bit more like this. You would expect with perfect weak scaling, you get constant runtime. If I have a problem which is 10 times as big and I run it on 10 times as many processors, if I've done a perfect job, my runtime will stay the same. But I haven't done a perfect job. So typically, if you see weak scaling plots, perfect parallelization in strong scaling is a 45-degree line. Perfect parallelization in the weak scaling is a horizontal line. And of course, our actual time diverges from that. So summary, you know, there's a variety of considerations for parallelizing a code. It's very important to quantify how well you have done. So scaling is important, and you've got metrics to indicate how well you're doing. And there are very simple performance models, Amdahl's law and Gustafsson's law, which are surprisingly good, at least give you a handle for discussing parallel performance. So, when you see a graph like that, you can go back and say, okay, that code isn't worth running on more than 256 processors. The scaling is starting to top out. But if I want it to go faster, where should I look? I should look for those parts of the program which aren't scaling well. Maybe there's I/O in this code. Maybe the code is doing I/O and doing it inefficiently. Maybe there's some part of the calculation I haven't parallelized. I'm replicating it across the processors, and it's not going any faster. So you can then carry on and try and improve the scaling. So that was a very quick overview of parallel scaling and performance. I've got three talks to give today. I'll start this second one and then we'll take a break at 3 and come back at 3:30 just so people get a break. But what I'm going to talk about is the building blocks. So in the next lecture, I'm going to say, how do we take these building blocks, multiple processors, multiple threads, to how do we take advantage of them to write parallel programs? But I have to sort of explain what processors and threads are. So I apologize to the local audience. I know from informatics background, this is probably familiar stuff to you, but for some of the people attending remotely, it may not be so familiar, but I will go through quite quickly. But I'll talk about what operating systems do, and I'll skim over some of this stuff. I'll only concentrate on the part which is important for this lecture or for the next lecture. I'll talk about processes and threads, and just to reiterate, the way we will parallelize our codes, the way we do parallelize codes is to use multiple processes and or multiple threads. And I'll talk a bit about how operating systems can be optimized for HPC. But what do they do? Well, operating systems are responsible for, your operating system, as we all know, is your Mac operating system, your Windows or Linux, whatever you have. The OS is responsible for orchestrating access to the hardware. The way modern computing works is you do not have direct access to the hardware. You're mediated by the operating system. So you don't access memory. You ask the operating system to give you memory, for example. The operating system decides which applications are running, how memory is allocated and deallocated, how is the file system accessed, and all things to do with, obviously, access permissions. But the concept of process and thread if you run modern, what I would call a program, but modern parlance is maybe called an application. An application is a single process. When you launch an application, it is a single process, but that process can have multiple threads. And as we all know, So for high performance computing, originally, it's almost always used Unix. They've always been Unix based. In the old days, Digital, Sun, Cray, IBM, Silicon Graphics all wrote their own versions of Unix, but now everyone uses Linux. So almost all HPC vendors will modify some commercial Linux distribution, Red Hat or SUSE, or tailor to their own system. If you build a commodity cluster, you might run a free distribution. But Unix is almost the only people who don't use Linux universally are IBM, who still support their own Unix AIX. But as of, this is a few years ago, but the top 500, I haven't had time to cover it, but it's a list of the most 500 most powerful parallel supercomputers in the world, of which Archer is round about number 20, I think, or something like that. Of the top 500 systems, only 11 don't use Linux. And only two systems in the top 500 use Windows. So, I mean, Linux is completely dominant in simply because it's, you know, first of all, it's free, largely free. As a company, you don't have to pay any development effort, so having teams developing your operating system is clearly expensive. But also, if everyone uses the same thing, there's a kind of a economies of scale. If everyone's using Unix, then Linux, then tools and things tend to be portable. And Windows just isn't suitable because Windows is a GUI-based, you know, inherently a GUI-based system. Okay, maybe a surprise to you, but we do fairly old-fashioned. Linux tends to interact with through the command line, so that's why the first exercise was fairly verbose in explaining how I won't dwell on that here. I'll talk about processes. So what is a process? Well, when you run a process, I hope I don't hit the wrong thing here. Let's start task manager. So we can see here I'm running, okay, so this machine, which is doing very little, all I'm doing is showing a few presentations, is running how many processes? 77 processes, okay? So every time you run a program, it becomes an operating system process. But you have to be aware that in normal operation, a computer runs hundreds of processes, many, many more processes than it has physical cores. This machine might have two or four cores, I don't know. So each application becomes a separate process in the OS, and the important part about process is it has its own memory space, which is not accessible by other running processes. So because of the way the virtual memory works, you have the illusion when you write a program, you believe that you have access to all the memory. You don't actually. What you're given is you're given a ring-fenced world. You have a block of memory which is ring-fenced from all other processes. Why is that the case? Well, if my web browser crashes and starts to scribble over data in memory, I don't want it scribbling over the document in my word processor. It's really, really important for, you know, older systems, the original Macs, for example, did not have this memory protection. So if one process went haywire and started to scribble over data, it would scribble over other processes' data. The old Macs used to crash like twice a day. I mean, so memory protection, the fact that processes are ring-fenced from each other, they cannot, without jumping through hoops, they cannot access another process's memory, allows you to have stable modern computers. It's a problem for us, though, because I've just said we're going to use multiple processes to do parallelism, and processes have to communicate with each other. We saw they need to talk to each other. If I was to give different parts of the UK to different processes in my weather simulation, they have to exchange data. How are they going to do that? And we'll see how to do that in the next lecture. Each process is scheduled to run by the OS. You get the illusion they're running at once. Of course, they're not all running at once. So you might say, wait a second. You're telling me that parallelism is very manual, that you have to basically take your problem, divide it up into different tasks, and make those tasks different processes or different threads, and then run them on different cores. Okay, that's fine. Why do people have multi-core laptops? Okay. I'm probably not running a parallel program on this laptop, on this machine. It might have four cores. Well, the important point is operating systems have always scheduled multiple processes. So they regularly check when a process is running every 10 milliseconds every hundredth of a second. They maybe say, you've had enough time, deschedule that, have something else. Let PowerPoint run for a bit, let Firefox run for a bit, let some network process run for a bit, to give you the illusion that applications are running concurrently. Even on the old single core processors, where you could only do one thing at once, they appear to be doing many things at once by very rapidly, relatively rapidly on the scale of possibly tens of milliseconds, are switching through different processes. So rapid process switching gives the illusion that applications run concurrently, even on a single core. Of course, if you have multiple cores, they can really run at the same time. So you can be watching a video, might run on one core, you might be doing web browsing on another core, doing editing a Word document on another core. And so at least at 4 or 8 cores, multi-core laptops are useful because they're running multiple processes, but they're running different processes. Each core will be running a different application. What we want to do is we want to run a single application across all the cores, which is a slightly different idea. So I've just here process scheduling, typically every 0.01 seconds, as I said, 10 milliseconds or so, there'll be some interrupt and the operating system will say, it will shuffle things around. So in a modern operating system, doesn't only have to decide what processes run, but it has to decide where they run. It has to basically decide who runs where, and it can move them around and such like. Some hardware supports multiple processes per core. This is called SMT, symmetric multi-threading, or Intel call it hyper-threading, but that's just something of a complication. But this process scheduling can be a hindrance to performance. So all this sophisticated stuff that modern operating systems do, we don't want in high-performance computing. If I have 4 cores in high-performance computing, I want to run 4 processes, I want to run 4 threads. I don't want them to be interrupted, switched around, and scheduled, and such like. And so an enormous amount of them, the complexity of modern operating systems, we don't need for HPC, and I'll talk about that bit at the end. So having stopped that, so that's processes. I'll stop there, because I'm now going to speak on about threads, which introduces the shared memory model, how we share memory. So I said, importantly, the most important thing about processes is that when you launch a process on a computer, it is given a memory space through the way that virtual memory works, which is isolated from other processes. And that's but in fact, if you have multiple threads, then they can share memory. So that basic parallelization models is to have a single problem and operate on it with multiple threads, because those threads can talk to each other because they can share memory. And I've got an example here and an analogy to talk about that. So I'll stop there and come back at 3:30 after you kind of tea or coffee break and carry on. I'll finish this lecture, then I'll talk about how we use these concepts to actually write real parallel programs. And hopefully in the break between now and next week, you'll be able to think about how to apply them to the traffic model. It is a useful thought exercise. And next week during the week, I'll put up actual solutions to the traffic model, which parallelize it using these two shared memory, distributed memory, threads-based, process-based parallelization models. Okay. Okay, so I think it's about maybe a minute or so. Just before I count you in that lecture, I realized I put up this code here. So I said, you have this code on the website. These are the solutions to the traffic model, serial solutions to the traffic model. And hopefully one of the C, Fortran, or Python ones you'll be able to look at. And at the end of the next lecture, you'll be able to think about how you could parallelize it. The code's quite straightforward, but think about how you might want to parallelize it. But I just wanted to say that these codes do actually work. So if I type make, I should be able to. It does compile the code. And if I run it, if I can remember how to run a code, it runs. So it says length of road is 100,000. It's going to do 2,000 iterations. I was aiming for a target density of cars of 0.52, which is just above, remember, at 0.5 car, at 50% filling, we will eventually get this asymptotic velocity of one. This is just above 50% filling, so it's just above. We should get a velocity. We'd expect a velocity just below one for this. It initializes the road. We initialize the road with random numbers, and you've seen we're going to fill each cell or not fill it with a 52% probability, but of course you're not going to get exactly the right density. So I get an actual density of cars of 0.517, which is pretty close to what it was. And then we run the simulation, and every 200 iterations it prints out the average velocity. And you can see that it's taking a while to converge. This is because it's this half filling is kind of a critical point. Just below half filling is, you know, it's going to be velocity one. Just above half filling is going to be velocity below one. So it takes quite a while to settle down here. So you can see even after 2,000 iterations, the velocity is still slowly increasing. This is as the cars are trying to arrange themselves, car gap, car gap, car gap, and it takes quite a long time to do that. This was explained in the sheet. If I actually make the target density more like, where do I set it here? Point. If I make it more extreme, like point 0.85, so pretty full, and I recompile, not only is the velocity much lower because we expect well above half filling, 85% filling, we're expecting it to be quite a low velocity. You can see that the simulation settles down. I mean, by 200 iterations, it's already settled down into a completely steady state. So it's when you're close to that, and the same for very low velocity. If I very low density, if I take the density to more like 0.25 or something and recompile, again, it's the velocity. Now, if I printed out every iteration, I could see that, so for example, if I take the print frequency to be, if I print every one iteration, and maybe only set the number, well, where's the number of iterations set? Let's say max iter equals 100. We can see that if I now recompile it, it wasn't what, you know, some of the cars were together at the start, you know, so we have average density of a quarter, so we had a few cars together, so it took about, how long did it take? But it took about 20 iterations. After 20 iterations, they'd all sorted themselves out, so not much happens. But you can see close to this critical point of 50%, it takes a lot longer to sort themselves out. So that's just, so I said, this is to try and illustrate the fact that when you run a computer simulation, i.e. that is not a simulation of a computer, but a computer simulation, I mean a simulation of a real physical system using computing, writing the program isn't just enough. You then have to play around and experiment and get the feel of how things are working. So there's quite a lot of experimentation. So computational science is once you've written the program, it becomes more like an experimental science. I think with the program is the experiment. You kick the tires and see what it does. Okay, so I'll get back to the lecture. So I'll talk a bit about threads now. So again, although we use them for parallel computing processes, they've been around for a long time. Threads have been around. Threads can share memory. So the important point is, for many applications, each process has a single thread. So if you write a normal program, it's a single process and it has one thread of execution. But you can create multiple threads. So a thread is like a child process contained within the parent process. So you have a process, and then it can spawn multiple threads. Here we have a process P0, and it spawns thread 0 and thread 1. And the important point is that threads are very much like processes on a modern operating system. They can be scheduled independently. They're effectively child processes. But the important point about a thread is it can share the memory of its parent process. So all threads in a process have access to the same memory. So again, threads predate parallel programming. What you would have done even on this, what you could have done many years ago, even on a single core processor, if you wanted to write a computer game, which was your process, you might create various threads which run asynchronously, one to control the spaceship, one to control the missile, one to deal with keyboard input. And again, these would appear to run concurrently, but in fact the operating system would be scheduling them in some time slice mode very quickly. But So, but all the threads would update the same game memory. To make this useful, the reason that it's useful to have threads accessing the same memory is all these threads could update the same screen, for example. If you think of that as your game memory, they could all update the screen. So that's the difference with threads. Although to a large extent, they're just mini processes, at least in modern operating systems, they can access the same memory. And that's a very important distinction. The OS scheduling policy is hopefully aware of threads. It will make sure all the game operations progress. And switching between threads is usually quicker than switching between processes. The reason is that you don't have to change the way the memory is set up. When you switch in a new process, you have to say, okay, right, here's the new process. It's got a new memory map. It's accessing new different areas of memory. And you have to set up this ring fencing and do lots of things. Threads, they all share the same. You don't have to change the memory configuration when you switch in a new process, a new thread, because they, by definition, they share the same memory space with each other and with their parent process. So how can we? So with multiple cores, multiple threads can now operate at the same time on the same data to speed up an application. That's not what they were. Again, it's not what they were originally designed for. They were originally designed to have concurrent operation, but now we want parallel operation. But the important point is you can't scale between the number of cores managed by the operating system. So, for example, if you have a quad core laptop, you cannot. You cannot use more than those four cores with multiple threads. All threads have to belong to a single parent process, which means that they can only scale to the limits of a single operating system. And as we've seen in HPC terms, a single operating system will manage a single node. So as we said, Archer, the national supercomputer, is a bunch of 24 core nodes, over 5,000 of them. But if you were to programming with threads, you could not write a parallel program that used more than 24 cores, because by definition, threads parallelism is by them sharing memory. And you can think of that as being a limit in two ways. One is you can think, well, all the threads have to become the same process. A process could only exist on one node on one operating system. Or you can think in a more physical way. These threads have to physically access the same memory. These 24 cores are all attached to the same memory, but another node, they're attached to a different memory in a distributed memory architecture. So you can think of it from a sort of a software and a hardware level. But it is important that with threads, the parallelism you can achieve with threaded programming is limited to a single multi-core node, or your laptop, or your desktop, however you want to think about it. So to scale beyond a single node, we need multiple processes, we need inter-process communication, we need different operating systems to speak to each other, different nodes to speak to each other, and we'll see how to do that later. So again, but the way you can do it is you had an array of size 8, and you wanted to operate on it, you wanted to multiply every element by 2, for example. It's quite straightforward, because you just say, well, you have the process, it has this array of size 8, and thread 0 can operate on elements A0 to A3, and thread 1 can operate on elements A4 to A7. And that's fine, because they can all access that array. You don't have to worry. It's not like a master worker example. We have to package up the data, send the data to thread 0, and thread 0 sends you the results back. They all have direct access to that array. So if an array is declared in the parent process, multiple threads can natively access that same array. Now you might worry, that sounds a bit anarchic. Different threads accessing the same memory at the same time, isn't all hell going to break loose? Well, that is the difficulty. It's coordinating that access, which is the challenge. But at least in principle, it's quite a straightforward model. You might have heard about, more recently, threads are associated with accelerators. So a modern multi-core chip might have 12, 24 cores. You might run 24 threads on that, but it's a few tens of threads. You typically do not run more threads than cores. Although the operating system can schedule more threads than there are cores, that's still a relatively heavyweight process. Still take quite a big hit to deschedule one thread and reschedule another one. It's not something you want to do. But things like graphics processors have thousands of cores, and they are designed to operate with tens of thousands of threads. And so the way that these work is that oversubscription of the accelerator by threads is encouraged. So what happens is graphics chips are designed, A, with lots of threads, because there's lots of parallelism in graphics processing. You know, a modern screen has 4K pixels, okay? Each pixel can be updated in sort of rate, largely independently. There's enormous amounts of parallelism in modern graphics. So that's why these graphics chips have thousands of threads, physical cores, right? Thousands of physical processors, very simple, but thousands of physical processor cores. But they're also designed to be able to switch threads very quickly. So you run tens of thousands of threads, and the hardware can switch threads in and out very quickly. And the reason that's good is, I sort of mentioned early on, the thing which modern processors are worst at is accessing memory. So what a graphics processor does is it runs a thread until it maybe has to load some data from memory. It then says, well, that thread's waiting for data from memory. I'll deschedule it, and hopefully there's other threads around to take up the space. So modern graphics processors are designed in hardware and in the operating system, the way they can schedule threads to support thousands of computing elements, tens of thousands of threads, and this massive oversubscription. That is not the case for normal multi-core processors where we have a standard Linux operating system. You really want to run the same number of threads as cores, but graphics processors are different. So GPU stands for general purpose graphics processor. GPU is originally designed for graphics because people like playing computer games, but we've kind of hijacked them for scientific and technical computing. So if you hear that a modern high-performance computer has a lot of accelerators, it will have possibly lots of GPUs in it. The one thing those GPUs can't do is do graphics. They'll have no graphical output, which is a bit bizarre. But they're used for calculation. So how do vendors get performance with their OS? Well, typically, the compute nodes will run some optimized operating system. Now, the front end, when you log on to Archer, you're on some login node on Archer, that will run a full operating system. You'll have, because that's where you want to run your tools and your compilers and such like. But when you submit a job via QSub to the compute nodes, they will typically have a very stripped down operating system. Again, in the early days, the very first generation of Cray systems, which came out maybe 10 years ago, maybe less than 10 years ago, 8 years ago, they had their own operating system called Catamount, I think it was called. But now they don't. We use a stripped down Linux, and you remove features that are not needed. So how do you optimize the OS? You take everything out. You take out USB support. You know, you don't need that. You don't need, probably don't need a lot of the software stack. You restrict the scheduling flexibility. So you say, I actually don't want you to move threads and cores around, threads and processors around. I want you to just leave them where they are. You increase the interrupt period. You say, don't check every 10 milliseconds, check every 100 milliseconds, every second. You bind processors and threads to specific cores because you don't want them to move around. You want them to stay there. And you remove support for virtual memory, at least in terms of paging. The Archer nodes are diskless. So although you know a modern operating system has virtual memory, so you can malloc an order of magnitude more memory than you have physical memory, and it will manage that and page it in and out to disk. We don't want that because we don't actually have any disk to page to. So all the sort of stuff like the sophisticated virtual memory paging is all turned off. So all this stuff is stripped down to make the operating system more performant. And so the basic model is, on a normal multi-core system running a general-purpose Linux operating system, if you've got four cores and you chuck four processors at it, you kind of hope that the operating system puts one process on each core, hopefully. Every now and again, they get descheduled and maybe moved around, but hopefully most of the time, that will be happening. But it's just a hope. You just have to hope. On Archer, on the compute nodes, which are very stripped down, it will place process 0 on core 0, process 1 on core 1, process 2 on core 2, and it will leave them there. And it will not touch them, and they'll just run until you're finished. And that's all done through Linux. Linux has support for pinning processes to cores. It's not something you do in everyday use, because it's not the kind of thing you want on a multi-use system. The other thing I haven't said, which is very important, on most modern supercomputers, the minimum... Yep. So your question is, what's your question? So you're right, there will be very few interrupts going on, because... So the question is, can you determine what tasks you perform? The way it works, and maybe cover this, is, you know, if I want to run I don't, so for example, if I'm running a threaded program, my process will spawn threads, and on Archer, it will guarantee that the first thread I spawn will go on a particular core, and the next one will go on next one. We'll just place them, count up the cores and place them. That's true. So that's the question is, if a thread is waiting on another thread, will that waste time? Yes, that will waste time. So the challenge there. So on a system like a GPU, where the operating system, the hardware is set up for very rapid thread switching, what you do is you run many more threads than cores. But on a more general purpose multi-core processor, at least nowadays, you tackle that in software. It's up to the programmer to make the load balanced, and that's actually what the Mandelbrot set example shows you. So you're right. You would think that the way to balance the load would be to run more processes or threads than physical cores, and that's the normal way you would do it. But the kind of to get very the problem is that the granularity of that isn't sufficient, and thread switching is still a pretty heavyweight operation. And so the way that it's solved in high performance computing, when you're going for very high performance, is solve that problem in software. You know, make sure that each thread. And so rather than, as I said, that's a very good question. So what you would do, we can go back to the example here. I think it was this diagram here. So on a GPU, what you would do. So imagine we have 16 physical cores. On a GPU, what you would do is you would run 64 threads and let the operating system assign them. What we do on a more standard multi-core system is we, through some master worker algorithm, assign those. We have 16 physical threads, and we manage the assignment of tasks to threads ourselves. So in a GPU system, you run lots of threads. You still have one task per thread and one lots of threads. What we do is we run one thread per core and have multiple tasks per thread, but we have to do that ourselves. So you're right, it doesn't sound ideal, but there are programming models evolving which do that, but the moment the standard method is to do that scheduling yourself. That's a very good question. So yes, the back end operating system tends to be fairly restricted. So what I'm going to do now is basically just I'm going to say, how do we actually, what are the parallel models which we use for, so hopefully the logical progression is that we've talked about how we can parallelize problems, we can decompose them in various ways. We've talked about processes and threads being the basic building blocks of the way that tasks are executed on a modern operating system, and the fact that the important point is that processes cannot natively read and write to the same memory location, whereas threads, by definition, can. How do we exploit that for parallel programming? So I'm going to talk about shared variables parallelism, which is typically implemented through threads on a shared memory architecture. Message passing parallelism, which is implemented through processes and maps more naturally to the distributed memory architecture, and a bit about the practicalities. So shared variables is threads-based parallelism. As I said, this scales up to a single operating system, a single multi-core node. And we've seen this concept before. Threads can all see the data of the parent process. We can run on different cores, and there's a potential for parallel speed up. So the analogy I have is I think of this as being like a very large whiteboard in a two-person office. So your whiteboard, or in this case here's a blackboard, is your shared memory, and you're saying, okay, so we have four people in an office, and they can collaborate on a task by reading and writing to this shared data, this large whiteboard or blackboard. The problem there is, how do they collaborate without interfering? So although you have shared data, as you start thinking about it, it's absolutely essential that you have private data as well. You need to have data which you can keep private to be able to work together but not interfere with each other. There's times that you want to work together, there's times you want to be able to do things yourself. The worry with having everything as shared data is that you can set a variable. I don't have any chalk here. But you can set a variable, X, And your neighbor could come over it and rewrite it and call it Y without you knowing, okay? That's a bit annoying. If you want a variable, you don't want the person that you need to have. So in fact, all you do, although physically all the memory is shared, logically you have private data. And if that's just like saying, look, the bottom left-hand corner of the whiteboard or the blackboard is mine. That'd be my private data. So in the shared memory model, threaded parallelism, you logically have two areas of memory. You have shared memory for shared data and private memory for private data. Now, physically, there is just a big block of shared memory, but we can decide to divide it up. So logically, there are these two spaces. And so the way we're going to communicate with each other is, threads have to communicate. You know, they're operating, as I said, a lot of calculations require, someone operating on element I to know the data from element I minus one and I plus one, and in principle they could be the responsibility of another thread. So how do threads communicate with each other? Well, we have a program, it's very simple, we have a simple program. The thread one says my A equals 23. Now, straight away in shared variables programming, you have the issue that you do not know if that variable is in shared or private data. Now, we'll see that there are ways of doing that, but by calling it my A, I've told you this is a private variable, okay? So there are, in a real system, there'll be ways of doing this, but my A means it's a private variable. So that goes into my private data. And then I can say something like A equals my A. And so if A is in shared data, that private data is copied into the shared data, into the shared space. And you can see that the shared data is accessible by both processes, by both threads, sorry. And so thread two can say my A equals A plus one, and that takes the value of A from the shared, because A is a shared variable, it takes it from the shared space and sets my A to be 24. So this illustrates two important things. A, that if threads want to communicate with each other, they do it by reading and writing to the shared space. Okay, that's how they communicate with each other. But B, if you have a private variable, so there is only one value of A. A is in shared data. There is one unique value of A. However, if you have private data, and I've called it here my A, they can have different values. So on thread one, my A is 23, and on thread two, my A is 24, for example. But for this to work, I've made an assumption here, which I haven't made explicit. This only works, so I've taken the value A, my A, sorry, of 23 on thread one, and I've passed it to thread two, who set my A equals A plus one via this intermediate shared variable. That's how they can communicate, by reading, writing, shared data. But I've made an assumption here, which I haven't made explicit. What is required for this to work? For this A to... I wrote these lines out in a particular order, okay? I assumed here that thread two executed my A equals A plus one after thread one had executed A equals my A. That wasn't the case, you wouldn't get the right answer. Okay, you'd pick up an old value. And so synchronization is crucial for the shared variables approach. In this way of parallel programming, it is the subtlety or the challenge is to make sure that if you're accessing either reading or writing shared variables, then the accesses take place in the order that you want them to. So in this case, thread 2's code must execute after thread 1. And a simple way to do this is a barrier synchronization. There are more sophisticated versions such as locks, but in simplest cases, what you can do is execute a barrier. You can all the threads execute a barrier, which say, we will all wait till this point till we all move on. So the barrier is like, you know, a line in the sand. Everybody waits till they get there, and then they move on again. So writing parallel codes is relatively straightforward. You have complete freedom, or you have some shared data. All threads can read and write at any point. So that's a relatively it's easy to program in that model. But it's actually difficult to get the, it's very easy to write incorrect programs. It's very easy to write programs which have what we call race conditions, where the runtime behavior is dependent on the timing. So one time, if you didn't put any synchronization in, this might work, because thread two might be a bit slower than thread one and you get the right answer. The next time you run it, thread two might be slightly faster than thread one and you get the wrong answer. So without explicit synchronization, this code does not have deterministic behavior. And though you might worry if you're playing a game that might give you a slightly glitchy output. If you're flying an aeroplane or something like that, then you might be a bit more worried about correctness. But code correctness is difficult. So for example, let's take a more realistic example. This is going back to adding up the numbers. imagine that I wanted to add up an array. I've got seven elements, A0 to A7, and I want to add them up. Well, we've seen already that we can trivially split that calculation between two into two tasks. So I'm going to say thread 0 should add up A0 to A3, and thread 1 should add up A4 to A7. And so the shared data is the main array A. We put that in shared memory because we just have the big array here, which everyone's going to access. And the result is shared. There's a single result, which is the sum of all the values of A. So the main array A and the result A sum are both shared. However, we need some private variables. We're going to do a little loop. So my loop count has to be private because we're both looping over. We're going to both execute this code. We're going to do loop I equals I start to I stop, my sum plus equals AI end loop. So what the way that we typically program threads in high performance computing is that every thread executes the same code. Both threads are going to execute that code, but they don't do the same thing because we mess around with some of the variables, like although they're both executing I equals I start to I stop, we can make I start and I stop different on different threads. To do that, of course, they have to be private. So the loop counter I and the loop limits I start and I stop are private. And I need a local variable, my A sum, to accumulate the value. So what we would do is the code is, we both execute that code, we both loop I equals I start to I stop, my A sum plus equals AI end loop, assuming A sum, my A sum was initialized. We would then both have a partial sum, and then we do this stage at the end where we have synchronization, where we have to accumulate these values. And because we're accessing a shared variable, we have to do some synchronization. So thread 0 might say A sum is plus equal to my A sum, then we have a barrier, and then thread 1 might say A sum plus equal to my A sum. The reason we need a barrier there is that if both threads access A sum at the same time, we can get the wrong answer. Yep. So there's a question of, you know, when do you need synchronization? So if you have a sort of what you might call trivially parallel calculation like the image sharpening, then you don't need, you know, each thread can just do its work and then finish. But typically, the example to think about here is how you would parallelize the traffic model, where on each iteration you need to know some of the data which has been updated by other threads. So you have a loop. You're continually updating data. On each iteration, you're accessing variables which are being updated by other threads, and you need to make sure they've finished. So, and here, it may not be obvious, but you think, why do I need to make sure that the two threads don't update A sum at the same time? It's because updating a variable is not a single atomic operation. A sum plus equal to my A sum is actually implemented by read A sum from memory into register, add to it and write it back. And if two people do that at the same time, you get the wrong answer. So you know that. So we have to order this. But you're right, it's not always necessary. And barrier synchronization is probably way over the top here. I've just used it as a simple example. But that's the challenge, is knowing when synchronization is necessary and when synchronization is not necessary. Now, the model we use for high performance computing, which is called OpenMP, is this directive-based model, which I showed you this hash pragma thing. You saw some previously. And what that does is it is designed for big bulk processing of arrays, and it is designed to put in synchronization where it's normally needed. So it has a conservative approach. So most programs you write with OpenMP will be correct because the model has synchronization. And you can take it out if you know what you're doing, but by default it puts synchronization in. Yeah. Yeah. Yes, so GPUs, you basically define a kernel. Right, so the question is, on a GPU, if all the threads are running the same task, do you need synchronization because they all finish at the same time? We don't actually know when they finish. The question is, how do you know when they finish? That's the other problem. In the main program, you've asked all these threads to update an image. you know, to update to the next frame, you're going to need some barrier at the end to say, right, has everyone finished? So you may not need fine control, but you may need to know, you often need to know, I just need to know everybody has finished. You know, wait until everybody has finished, and now I know I've completed that frame and I can display it. So synchronization is more complex in GPUs because threads are, the model is designed for threads to run independently, and synchronization is quite heavyweight, quite over. So the GPU model is that for most of the time they run independently. Then every now and again you would need a synchronization. If you need a lot of inter-thread synchronization, then that is very difficult to implement on GPUs. They do not work well. So when you need lots of synchronization, you need models like graphics is a classic, you know, example. You've got 4K, 4,000 pixels to update. You know, then we've got a lot of parallelism there. So this example is a typical pattern called a reduction. It's very common in scientific and technical codes to have a loop like this. A sum equals if I equals not I less than I double plus A sum plus equal to A of I. If we said only one thread at a time can update A sum, it removes all the parallelism. We're all queuing up to update A sum. So as you've seen, each thread accumulates its own private copy. And we only need synchronization at the end when they do this final reduction, because addition is associative. We can update in that different orders. If the number of operations is much larger than the number of threads, so n is very large, each thread still has a large amount of calculation to do. This can proceed mostly in parallel. This is such a common pattern that programming it up like this by hand is you can do it by hand here. You know, loop counters, loop limits, local variables, synchronization. It's such a common pattern that the models we use for high-performance computing, like OpenMP, automate this. You just say, do this in parallel, and it will, under the hood, it's doing all this stuff for you. It's spawning threads, it's synchronizing, it's computing the loop limits. But as a programmer, you just give a single pragma. So OpenMP is designed to cope with the common situations that you come across in large-scale parallel codes. You could program it by hand, but that's a waste. So the hardware, we need support for shared memory architecture. As I said, the model is four people in the same office all accessing the same whiteboard or blackboard. It only works if you have multiple processors or cores attached to the same physical memory through some bus. So this needs the support for shared memory architecture. It means it's limited to, not on a GPU, it's limited, there are lots of threads, but a normal multi-core architecture is limited to a few tens of cores. That's the scalability of this. So shared blackboard, I think, is a good analogy for thread parallelism. It requires a shared memory architecture. The threads operate independently on the shared data. If you want synchronization, you have to put it in by hand. And high-performance computing, and you'll see, I'll hand out a solution for the traffic model. It uses OpenMP directives, which is open multiprocessing, MP stands for. It supports common parallel patterns such as reductions. So the compiler does a lot for you, which is quite useful. There are equivalent. In fact, OpenMP is now supports GPUs. Rather than having to program GPUs by hand, and the model is normally called CUDA, which is quite low level, you define individual tasks and say which tasks run on which threads. OpenMP, you can now apply OpenMP directives to GPUs. So message passing is how we do process-based parallelism. So the problem with threaded programming is it doesn't scale past a single node, as we saw modern processors have. That would say you couldn't run on more than 24 cores of Archer when Archer has 120,000 cores. You need to run to communicate between different nodes. You need to communicate between different processes. So my analogy for process-based parallelism, where you can't share data, is two people in different offices. This is distributed memory. You're in one office with your blackboard or your whiteboard. Your colleague is in another office in Australia with their data, which is the same as two processes on different nodes attached by some interconnect, some physical network. How do they collaborate to work on a single problem? Well, the issue here is that any communications you make has to be completely explicit. So in threaded programming, shared variables, shared memory programming, communications is sort of implicit. It's implicit by reading and writing to shared variables, you're implicitly communicating. and the hardware sort of does it for you. Here you have to say, if I want to communicate with my neighbor, I need to pick up the phone and I need to phone them. So communication is much more explicit here. There is no shared data. You cannot share data because the other person cannot see your whiteboard or your blackboard. So it's a very much like distributing a problem where you communicate by picking up the phone or sending emails. So in the same diagram, process one now has, we don't have to say whether something's A or my A. Now there is no shared data in message passing programming, in distributed memory programming. You have your own data, that's it. So process one has its variable A, and so all data is in some sense private. And if it wants to send that data to process two, so this is process one's memory space. If it wants to send that data to process two, it has to do something explicit. It has to say, I want to send that data to process two. So what you're given is a library routine, typically. There's a magic library routine called here send, which says send A to process two. And that will send the data. But as we said before, processes can't alter this data. If on your laptop, you know, your PowerPoint process could update the memory of your Firefox process, then all hell would break. Everything would go wrong. So process one cannot put this data into process two's memory. So the only way that this communication could happen is if process two is actively involved. So for this to work, process two has to actively receive the data. Process two has to say, I want to receive the data from process one, and I will put it into variable B. And the analogy I've drawn here is that just an analogy. When the send happens, I'm imagining that the send goes, it's like sending an email, but this goes into some inbox. Then imagine that process two has some inbox where incoming messages go. I mean, it's not a bad analogy. Message passing programming, distributed memory programming, is like distributing a calculation amongst lots of colleagues where you communicate by email. So sending a message is like sending an email, but the important point, sending an email is a two-ended process. I send an email to somebody, I have not transmitted the information. They have to actively read the email. So process-based message passing programming is two-sided, active sends and active receives, which have to match up. So at that point, process two can say, I want to receive a message from process one, and I will put it in, I have control over my memory. Process one can't write into it. I will decide, I will put that into variable B, and then I can say A equals B plus one. So, again, although we've just got a variable A, it's important to realize that there are two A's here. There's the A on process one blackboard, and there's the A on process two's blackboard, and they are different. So although they both have a variable A, it can be to have different values. Now, in threaded shared variables program, that required us to explicitly say, look, we have to have a variable my A. Yep, sorry. Yep. Okay, so the question is there any acknowledgement? And I'll cover that in the next. That's a very good question. So that is a very, very good question. The question here does process one know whether process two has received the data, which is not true when you send an email, at least not by default. So I'll cover that. I hopefully extended this lecture to include those slides, so hopefully it should be on the next slide. But the important point is it's an active process. So synchronization is not obvious, but synchronization is essential for correctness in shared variables threaded programming. If you get the synchronization wrong, you get the wrong answer. In MPI, in message passing, typically you don't get subtle synchronization issues. The synchronization is automatic in the message passing. So imagine if you think of sending a message as being like making a phone call, and this is where we do get acknowledgement. The worry about threaded programming is if things happen in different orders, then you get different answers. But in message passing program, because it's so explicit, it doesn't matter. Because if I make a phone call, if I pick up the phone early, I wait for you to pick up to receive it. So we automatically synchronize. If I'm receiving, then and the phone's ringing, I can decide when to answer the phone. And so it may not be obvious, but the synchronization happens automatically when messages are synced. I'll cover it, but the synchronization is is done by the sending and the receiving. In fact, it's the receiving which does it. There is no danger of accidentally corrupting someone else's data because there's no shared blackboard. I don't have to worry that my data is going to change. My data cannot change. If I want to receive a message, I issue a receive. If I don't, I don't issue a receive. But that's not quite answering your question. Sending a message can be synchronous or asynchronous. So synchronous send is like making a phone call. It's not completed until the message has started to be received. So if I make if I send a message synchronously, I get information when it's received. And in fact, what happens is I don't actually get an explicit acknowledgement. What happens is it doesn't complete. So what happens if I pick up the phone and phone you, I just wait for you to pick up. So I know when synchronous send completes, I know the message has been received. So the underlying protocol will have some handshaking, but as a programmer, synchronous send, when it returns, I know when the message has arrived. If I do an asynchronous send, it completes as soon as the message is gone, so it's like sending an email, and I never know if it's received or not. Receives are usually synchronous. So this is where, when I receive a message with message passing, I just say, I want to receive a message, and I just wait for it to come in. And that's the normal model. There are extensions to that, but that's the normal model. You can send a message synchronously or asynchronously, like making a phone call or sending an email, but the receive is normally blocking and something. We just wait for it to come in. So the analogy, this is a bit old slide. So the old analogy was synchronous send was like sending a letter. Faxing a letter. That basically, in the old days, you went and put a letter in a fax machine, you pressed the button and you waited, and when you got a beep back, you knew it had been received. Now, modern faxes scan and all kinds of things. So I think making a phone call is possibly a better analogy, that you make a phone call and basically you wait till somebody picks up the line. So it's synchronous that you're synchronized in time. An asynchronous send is like posting a letter. You only know when the letter has been posted, not when it's been received. And so, which is just like sending an email. And there's a whole bunch of questions you might ask, which I'm not going to cover, like, if I send two letters, are they ordered? Do they overtake each other? You know, so message passing systems are quite sophisticated, that they preserve message ordering. You have to do that, you know, because if I send you a message with work and then send you a message saying, that's the last piece of work I want you to have, if they overtake each other, you get the wrong answer. So the analogies of sending emails and things lending letters don't necessarily hold in all, because letters aren't ordered. If I send two letters, they can arrive out of order. But fundamentally, making phone calls and sending emails sending faxes and sending letters are good analogies. So we've considered point-to-point communication, which is one sender, one receiver. In general, you want higher level constructs, because you don't always want to do point-to-point communications. You sometimes want to do more global things. So for example, and these are called collective communications. So simple message communication between two processes, it's like sending an email, but there's lots of instances when communication between groups of processes is required. And so they're elevated to a higher level because they're so important. And so obvious ones are, for example, broadcast. I mean, for example, at the start of the traffic model, I might read in from file how many iterations I want to do. I want to tell everybody what that is. I want to tell all the other processes, all the other processes what I'm doing. So I would broadcast that value, the value of n. N is 2,000. Everyone knows. So broadcast from one process to all others. I might have number 8, and it's broadcast to all the other processes. Scatter is a bit different. You can imagine in the traffic model, if I have a long road, I've read it in from disk, so I have the road, but I want to divide up. I want you to have the first 1,000 cells, you to have the next 1,000, you to have the next 1,000. That's not a broadcast. It's sending different data. So that's called a scatter. And that's, again, it's a collective operation. Everyone's involved. It's not a point-to-point communication. It's a collective communication amongst all the processes, but it scatters the data. And you can see this would be a useful thing to do at the start of the traffic models. Read in the data, hopefully you have enough memory on a single process, and then scatter it out. So that chunks up the data. So if I had an array of 0, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, it might be split up 0, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 across the processes. And the reverse operation is gather. At the end of a calculation, everyone has their own. We're updating the weather across Great Britain. We all know what our local weather is, but we want somebody to gather all the data together to write it out to file. So gather is another operation. And these are the reason that that they're elevated to a higher, they're a higher level operation. She says, though, of course, you can implement these via point-to-point communications. The naive implementation is not always the best implementation. So, for example, if you want to do a broadcast, you might say, well, that's obvious what I should do. I should send a message. If I'm the boss guy, I just send a message to everybody. A message to you, a message to you, a message to you, a message to you. If you've got 1,000 processes, that's, you know, going to be very slow. But you could nominate some people ourselves and send a message to you, and message to you, and could you not send it to 500 people? And then you can have tree-based algorithms or hyperQ-based algorithms. So there are ways of implementing these things which are much quicker. So the naive broadcast scales like takes. If you have P processes, it takes order P time, because I have to send P messages, which if you've got 100,000 processes, it's going to be a nightmare. But a more sophisticated algorithm might take log time. You know, I have a tree algorithm which can broadcast in log P time, and that can become, you know, that can be, the difference between P and log P is huge. If P is 10,000, 100,000, the differences are massive. So again, you should use collective operations where you can, because they will have been implemented efficiently, hopefully. At least there's a chance they have. So, and the most common one is a reduction operation. Combine data from several processes to form a single result. Again, if you think about the traffic model, if we were to parallelize that using distributed memory, each process would have a subsection of the road. So process one might know that 5 cars have moved on its section of road. Process two knows that 3 cars have moved. Process three knows that 7 cars have moved. I don't care how many cars have moved on random sections of the road. I want to know how many cars have moved in total. So we have to combine all that data and produce a single result. Everyone has their own number of cars that have moved, but globally there's only one global number. Or if I want to compute the average age of everybody in this lecture theatre, you all have your own age, but there's only one average age. I would add all your ages together and divide by the number of people. So reduction operations are key to large parallel computations. You do them all the time. So we combine data from several processes to form a single result. So you can do summation, max, min, product, any associative operation. So here we've asked a simple question like, I don't know, should Scotland be an independent country? And 2 million people say no, and 2.2 million people say yes. I can't remember what that. But there's a single result that everyone's happy and everyone agrees on, hopefully. So, but anyway, you get a single result out of distributed data. So reductions, again, we could do a global summation. If we add 0, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, we get an answer, 15. So in terms of how this maps to hardware, the reason that that message passing programming has been the natural thing to do is that it maps directly, naturally, to distributed memory hardware. We have separate processors connected by an interconnect, so you run different processes on these processors, and they send data to each other over the interconnect. We run one process per processor core, and messages go over the interconnect, which you can think of as going between nodes or between operating systems. It is like sending emails between different computers. That's the way of transmitting data. You might say, well, wait a second. This was a very nice diagram to draw 15 years ago when we had single core processors. You might say, wait a second. These processors have got, these nodes have got multiple cores on them. It doesn't look like that. It's not 8 processes connected to an interconnect. It's actually, I'll jump ahead, it's actually 2 quad-core processors connected to like that. So what do you do here? Well, typically, we ignore the architecture. Typically, we pretend we have single-core nodes. So we run 8 processes on the 2 nodes, and the processes on a node send messages to each other. Although they're on the same node and they have shared memory, they send messages to each other. That is like, yeah, sharing an office with somebody and phoning them, right? Sounds crazy, but it's not crazy because it's not crazy for quite subtle reasons, but the reason you might think it's not is actually you have to write a message passing program to use multiple nodes. There's no way that those 2 nodes can communicate with each other through shared memory. Having done that, you might think, well, it's crazy for the 2 processes on this node to communicate via 2 processes on this node to communicate via messages when they could use shared memory. Well, sending a message between these 2 is going to be very quick because it's not going over the interconnect. So the operating system will be clever enough to do it through shared memory somehow or other. So you're only limited by the slow part, okay? So speeding up this part doesn't really help you. This part is the slow part, okay? So the fact that it might seem a bit crazy to talk to your, to phone your office mate is not a big deal, because it's when you phone your colleague in Australia, it takes a long time. So it may seem, now you can combine the two models. You could run one process here and one process here. The processes communicate via message passing, but you could populate these cores with multiple threads. You can do that, and people are starting to do that, but it's quite complicated, and it's quite complicated. So processes cannot share memory. They're ring-fenced from each other. It's analogous to whiteboards in separate offices. The communication is all explicit, analogous to making a phone call, if you think of synchronous communication, sending an email in the asynchronous case. And in fact, the reason that we don't typically have subtle synchronization issues in message passing programs is that because the receive is synchronous, basically you wait, basically you're in control, you're in complete control of your own memory space. So basically, you know, if you want to send a message, you explicitly send it, then you're happy. If you want to receive data, you explicitly receive it. If the send happens before the receive waits. If the receive happens before the send waits. So they tend to the synchronization is kind of done for you. And the way that we almost universally do message passing in modern parallel computing is through a library. It's just a library of function calls, so it's standardized to be called from C++ or Fortran, though there are versions you can call from Python, which just give you send, receive, and collective operations. So MPI, the message passing interface, is MPI, the message passing, is universally used for parallel programming. So on Archer, 99.9% of the programs run on Archer will be message passing programs. They may also use OpenMP to do the threading on a multi-core node, but they will all have message passing at some level, because that's the only way you can run a single parallel program across multiple nodes. I had one other comment to make here, which I... this was the message passing on shared memory. You run one process per processor core. You typically exploit the shared memory as an analogy is phoning your office mate, but it worked very well in practice, because actually that's not your limiting factor. Your limiting factor is phoning Australia, not phoning your office mate. And you'll see this if you actually do the exercises, but what you typically do is you compile a program and you have a launcher application, which is typically called MPI run or MPI exec, where you say, please could you run 50 copies of this program? And there is some control over allocation of processes to nodes. I mean, the way that Archer does it is the obvious way. By default, it would load up the first, processes 0, 1, 2, and 3 will be on the first node. Processes 4, 5, 6, and 7 are on the second node. It loads them up one by one. You have more fine-grained control if you really want it, but by default, it does kind of the natural thing. That's why this hybrid model of shared memory and distributed memory in the same program is difficult, because when you launch your message passing program, you have to say, look, I don't want processes 0, 1, 2, and 3 on node 0. I want process 0 on node 0, and then I want process 1 on node 1, because I'm going to use those other cores with threads. It just becomes technically quite involved. Messages between processes on the same node are fast, but remember, they share access to the network. So that's the problem about multi-core nodes, you only have one network connection to each node. If you have multiple cores, you have multiple processes, and they can all be firing data down the network. So multi-core nodes place a lot of stress on the network, because you can have multiple people sending and receiving messages down that. Yep. Yeah. So the question is, can we use shared memory on a node? Well, the difficulty is, it's a bit of a rigid model. The problem is that with threads, you have to have decided, with the process thread model, you have to have decided right from the start that you're going to use one process there on this node, and it's going to use four threads or three extra threads. So it's hard to, you can't sort of mix and match the model. Yet you could manually, You could create shared. It sounds crazy, but MPI deals in processes, and OpenMPI deals in threads, and then they're different things. What you ought to be able to do is to run. What you'd like to do is run multiple threads here, okay, which can communicate through MPI if they want, but communicate through shared memory if they want. And you can do that. MPI does support multiple threading, but it is not very efficient. It's not very efficiently done. So it's kind of the next stage. That's what people are looking at now, more seamlessly integrating message passing and threaded programming. So actually, I should say that the most modern version of MPI has a model where processes can read and write, they can allocate shared data. So there is a model now where, although you have multiple processes here, they can pretend to be threads, they can allocate shared data and read and write directly to that shared data and only send messages if they need to. So all these things are there, but at the moment they're kind of unnatural. It may seem crazy, but they're threads and processes have been, multi-core nodes have come, they're not modern, but they're not, they mess things up. The models that we use very much say you either have single core processes or multi, and they don't match up very well. So the question is, how does a process look like? It is just, you write a program and the operating system just runs it. So it is just a standard program running there. So what you do is you would run four copies of your program, and the operating system would hopefully be clever enough to run copy one there, copy two there, copy three there, and copy four there. They're just programs running, and if they just run, they just run. They'd never talk to each other. But if they want to talk to each other, they can call, send and receive, or collectives. Okay, so the question is, within that program, you could use it. Yes, you could. You could, but the problem is, if you've launched four processes here, you already have processes running on these things, and when you spawn the threads, they're going to conflict with the processes. So you'd hope the processes would then become descheduled, but it doesn't. Okay, so. Yes, so the question is, do you have any control? So if you want to do this hybrid model of processes and threads, what you do is you would put a process here and a process here, and then when they spawned threads, they would go here and they would go here. So you can do that, but you've already, it's a lot of work, because you could just run, that would be saying to utilize this architecture, run a two-process message passing program where each process uses four threads. But you've already got a parallel program. You can just run eight processes, put them there, 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 and there. You've already written the MPI, so it kind of works. You can do it, but it's actually a lot of work.
I'm just thinking
So you're right. So the question is, what's the overhead? You're right. In principle, the overhead of using messages on a node is an overhead. But in practice, the effort of putting an OpenMP everywhere in your code to use threads can outweigh that. They're very good questions. They're really at the forefront of what one of the biggest questions at the moment is, how do you effectively program these distributed architectures? When you've got four cores, you might think, well, I don't really care. But when you've got 24, 48, 100, 200 on the Xeon Phi, you're starting to think, you might think, I don't have enough memory of trying 200 processes. There's no very good questions. And there are solutions at the moment, but none of them are particularly elegant. It's all a bit of a, it's an interesting time in HPC for that reason. So summary, shared variables parallelism uses threads, requires a shared memory machine, easy to implement but limited scalability. In HPC we use something called OpenMP. Distributed memory uses processes. You can run on any machine because the messages can go over the interconnect. It's harder to implement, but typically better scalability because you can scale to multiple nodes. On HPC, we use the MPI library. There's a real unfortunate nomenclature that MPI is a library and there are multiple implementations. There's a free implementation of MPI called OpenMPI. It has nothing whatsoever to do with OpenMP. They're completely different. OpenMP is a set of compiler directives for implementing thread-based parallelism on shared memory machines. OpenMPI is a freely available implementation of the MPI library, and it causes endless confusion. They should never have called it OpenMPI, but they did. So you have so that OpenMPI has got nothing to do with OpenMP. OpenMP was first. So OpenMPI, I don't think should have. You can say OpenMP is a bit of a funny name, but OpenMPI, I don't think should have been called OpenMPI. A number of times you have a conversation with people and you find out after a couple of days that you've been talking completely cross purposes, because they have an OpenMPI program, they meant OpenMP, or they have the OpenMP program, they meant OpenMPI. It is unfortunate. Okay, so that was all I had to say. I'll just very briefly, slightly out of time, but if I go back to the web page just to show you what's up there. The slides are here. The exercise is A, to attempt the parallel parts of the traffic modeling exercise. If you look at the traffic modeling exercise, at the end there was stuff about the serial program. I've put examples of the serial program. There were parallelization, message passing, and shared variables implementation. So basically, to think about how you would parallelize the traffic model in these traffic simulation in these two models. So that's I've put that up there. The other thing I've put up is also a fractal exercise. This is to illustrate load balance. So it's a simple task farm, a master, a controller, worker setup for the Mandelbrot set, and it illustrates load imbalance. That this is the sheet, but you get nice pictures. There's a nice picture, and the important point about this calculation is, I can't remember, this is maybe 2,000 by 2,000 grid of pixels. It is 1,000 times more complicated, it's 1,000 times more costly to compute the points inside the Mandelbrot set than outside the Mandelbrot set, because you basically iterate away and see if it diverges. So it's maybe, this is 1,000 times, so there's a huge, if somebody's doing this region, they're 1,000 times faster than the person doing this region. So you cannot, if you have four processes, you can't divide this picture up into four, because somebody will have no work to do. So what we do is we divide it up. We have the classic approach for a task farm. You can see the coloring it indicates the task size. The task size is much, I've run this with 16 workers and 256 tasks. And so basically we have a controller who is giving out the tasks, and then when they're finished, giving them back out again. And I've colored the image to try and show you who does what. It gets a bit, it's not perfect, but the shading tells you which worker did which task. But there's some, quite a lot of, and you can do something quantitative here, because by looking at the load, the program prints out a load imbalance. It says, look, the heavily loaded, most heavily loaded processor did 10 times more work than the most lightly loaded processor. From that, you can actually guess what your maximum speed up is and see if you can get to that. You never quite get there, because by using smaller and smaller tasks, the load is better balanced, but the overhead, because the smaller the task is, the more tasks you have to distribute. So you don't ever quite reach, you hopefully will see, is the time, you can predict what your theoretical minimum time is, the time should come down, and just as you get there, it will start to go up again, because just as you're starting to balance the load, and you start to get communications overhead. So it's supposed to show that trade-off of granularity versus performance versus granularity. I will also, during the week, put up the parallel solutions to the message passing. The parallel solutions to the traffic model. I print out a rate here. Update rate was 65 megacops, 65 million car operations per second. You should get much larger numbers when you run in parallel. So even if you run this on your laptop, you should see that you can maybe get twice or four times that performance, just depending on whether you have two or four cores. So that's I'll put that up. It's worth thinking about it conceptually first, but I will put up those examples. I think that's everything. Let's just go back. Excellent. Attempt the parallel parts fractal from what it's given out in week. Well, that's correct. There's the exercise sheet. Oh, the other thing. The other thing is I've put up serial solutions and example results from the Sharpen exercise. Sorry. So if you run the Sharpen exercise, you get timings. But now we've talked about performance metrics, speed up, efficiency, and Amdahl's law. These are quite old results, but if you plot your results, you should see something which looks a bit like this. where if you plot the speed up against the number of MPI tasks, that's the perfect speed up. That's the overall runtime here, and that's the calculation time. And the difference between these is actually the I/O. So the reason that the what you should see is that to a large extent these curves should follow a sort of a classic Amdahl's law curve, a fixed overhead plus a diminishing parallel part. But the overhead here is the I/O time. So I compute two times in the code. The overall runtime, and I compute the calculation time, which is just calculating the image, and just updating the pixels, which is embarrassingly parallel. The difference between those should be the I/O time, and it should be relatively constant. This isn't timing, so you don't see here, but the difference between the overall runtime and the calculation time should be constant, a few tenths of seconds, which is the I/O time. So that corresponds to your serial fraction and the power fraction. This is a slightly, the graph isn't quite as clear as I'd hoped because of, this was on an old architecture, but on Archer, I should really redo these on Archer. You should get a much more clear result. But you see that on a real code, you do get this kind of curve that you would expect from Amdahl's law, that it starts off pretty linear, but as you use large numbers of processes, large numbers of cores, you get this tail off because it's the law of diminishing returns. You always have this fixed, in this case, of order a couple of tenths of a second I/O overhead, which you can't get rid of. And the curve will be different on Archer because the balance of computation to I/O in this case is slightly different. But again, this example was designed to give this kind of classical Amdahl's law speed up. Okay, thanks everyone. So as I said, there's quite a lot to be getting on the web pages, and I'll maybe put the parallel solutions up. I'll put it up before next week. Next week we'll be talking not so much about parallelism, but about numerical scientific computing, floating point numbers, things to do with data storage and access, testing and validation, and some numerical analysis and linear algebra. It'll be very much an overview of these. I'll spend most of my time talking about floating point numbers. That's quite interesting. It's not immediately obvious how you store a pi or square root of 2 on a computer, given that computers can only store ones and zeros. And then we'll talk about what implications they have, and just cover a few standard numerical analysis topics. Solving linear equations, matrix equations is the classic one here. It's quite a sort of classical problem. That's linear algebra. And then in the final lecture session, I'll talk more about random numbers in Monte Carlo and a bit about PDEs and particle methods, but I got a steer from Bob Fisher, who I talked to quite a bit about this before I did this course, that probably random numbers in Monte Carlo was the most useful part. So I'll talk a bit about that there. I'll touch on things like Markov chain Monte Carlo sampling methods, and I'll try and motivate that using the traffic model, actually, whereas the basic numerical analysis code is illustrated with a code which simulates comets orbiting the sun, which is quite fun to do, hopefully. Okay, thanks everyone.